All right, Pete, thank you. Hi there, I'm Brianna Keeler. I want to welcome our viewers here in the United States and around the world. We're a nation in free fall, in a crisis of historic proportions. Nearly 3,000 Americans reported dead in one day. This is the most since the coronavirus pandemic began. Hospital and frontline workers are keeping this country afloat. They're saving lives, and they're bearing witness to the suffering firsthand. While leaders in both the executive branch and Congress have failed so far to compromise on a much-needed rescue package. The numbers here are difficult to fathom, but these are people, these are families, and a new Tampa Bay Times investigation on the haunting toll of an outbreak inside of just one nursing home really drives home the human impact of this virus. In the span of just a month, Margaret Lally died on April 20th of COVID-19. The next day, Gene Lasner died. So did Donald Jack, who was a Cubs fan. The following day, Christopher Pugh died. And then 48 hours later, Susan Jones. The next day, Eleanor Schuneman passed away, along with Jeanette DeFrank. 2 days after that, Donna Mortensen died, who almost reached her goal to live to 100 years old. Four people died the next day. One of them was Sue Stevenson. The Times reports that her daughter tried to lift her spirits with FaceTime calls, but her mom could barely speak. Only able to respond, "I love you, bye." Emily Sudol died an hour after Sue Stevenson, a Korean War veteran temporarily in the facility recovering from a fall, still lived in his home and enjoyed meeting friends for beers at their local bar. Not long after that, George Egolf died, as did Anthony Fabrizio. Marjorie Blackman, a nurse at the home, was put on a ventilator as her daughter begged for blood plasma for her mom on Facebook. This is Tamara holding a photo of her mom. Marjorie died just a day later. Eunice Angeloni was a Londoner. She met her husband, Grimaldo, during World War II. He was an American soldier, and eventually she came back to America with him to raise a family. She died on April 30th. 2 days later, Avis Lilly died. So did Constance Bentler. She told her daughter, "I don't want to live anymore. I've tried. I'm done." 48 hours later, Alice Ford died. Louise Johnson passed away the next day, as did Harry Nash, who was a local bookshop owner who spent a lot of his time usually winning chess matches there. The next day, Beverly Dickman died. 24 hours later, five people died, including Russell Doughton. He was a magician who was still performing balloon animal shows twice a week. And Patricia Lewandowski died after 25 days on a ventilator. That was one horrific month at one nursing home. 32 had died. 32 of the 273,000 Americans who have died from this pandemic. Leonora Lapeter Anton and her colleagues at the Tampa Bay Times worked in conjunction with PBS's Frontline to bring this story to light, and they interviewed dozens of these family members who lost loved ones in the outbreak, as well as former and current employees. And I should say the reporters also reviewed hundreds of emails, inspection reports, legal documents, and medical records. Leonora, this report that you all did was amazing. There is one name that didn't mention there, the very first death in that nursing home, and that is Thomas Minichillo. So I'm wondering if you can share his story with us and how his coronavirus infection was handled.
So Thomas Minichillo arrived. He was a retired postal worker. He had a lot of medical problems, and he ended up in Seminole Pavilion after a hospital stay. So his wife often visited him and was very close to him. They'd been married for 59 years. And so, he was put in a room, and then all of a sudden she stopped being able to talk to him. And she learned that he was put in a shared room, and this was like in early April. So, you know, at first she spoke to him on the phone a couple times a day, but then after a while, they were telling her, well, he can't come to the phone. He's too tired. He doesn't want to. She went to the window where they were. He wasn't there. The window of the room that he was in. He wasn't there. He'd been moved to another room, and he went silent. And so, on April 5th, Seminole Pavilion apparently sent him to the hospital in an altered mental state. And then on April 9th, the 74-year-old tested positive coronavirus. On April 10th, he died. And nobody found out that he had died until a week later, the public, I mean. They didn't announce a death at the facility until a week after his death.
And what? Why the delay?
I'm not sure. You know, they did. We asked them tons of questions. We sent them like 3 dozen questions like a month or so ago, and they didn't respond. But I mean, everybody was sort of reeling from this pandemic at the time. It was very early, but they were particularly hit hard. And it just seems like, they didn't take the steps that were necessary to protect the residents initially.
So, I mean, clearly they were overwhelmed, but you also say in the article you reached out to Freedom Square administrators for interviews, and they declined. We also reached out for comment this morning. They said that they take these matters very seriously, but that they needed more time to prepare a response. I know you have received a statement from them. What did this say?
It said, let me see, hold on a second. Sorry, okay. Our residents' and staff's health is and always has been our number one priority. We are fully committed to the health and well-being of everyone in our community, employees and residents alike. We will continue to do all in our power to keep and maintain a safe and healthy environment here at Freedom Square.
And, you know, one of the things I also read that you wrote, Leonora, was about your own father, who passed away while at an assisted living facility in July. I have to say, this article that you wrote about him, it was an amazing tribute. And I'm sure that there are so many children of elderly parents who connect very much with what you said. But I also just, I got such an amazing sense of the person that he was, which I know is what you were trying to achieve with that. And I was just hoping that you could share with our viewers some of that.
So my dad was 96 years old. He was a real wisecracker, and he had been in the assisted living facility. I brought him down 4 years ago, and he was there for four. He was here 4 years ago. He was originally from New York City. He'd been an elevator inspector, an insurance person in my youth, and he took care of me. When I was a young girl in junior high and high school, he was the person who was there, there for me. He was a single dad for me at that point in time. So he's the person I went to with everything when I was a kid. And we had a very, very strong relationship. And I would go to see him like several times, a week I tried every day, but, at least 4 times a week I would go to see him. So we had a regular thing going on. It was kind of interesting because when I was a young girl, we used to go out to eat all the time at places because he didn't really cook. And then when he got older and came to live with me, we went out to eat again all the time. And he so looked forward to going out to those meals with me. And he still wanted to live. So it was really sad when he caught the coronavirus, ended up in the hospital, and died in July at age 96. And he was a wonderful man.
Yeah, it's a beautiful story about your dad, Bob. And you also talk about how you needed those moments as well. So, look, we're very thankful that you're here to talk about your reporting. We are incredibly sorry for your loss. I know this story is very real for you personally. And thank you so much for your work.
Thank you.
Leonora, we really appreciate it. Leonora LePeter-Anton. Vaccines are a critical step in the effort to stop the spread of coronavirus. And next week, the FDA